that build-up. Just to warn you that this liberal lefty feminist is going to disappoint all expectations, because I'm going to talk to you about falling in love. It was a windy July day in West Cork, and I'd fallen in love with a boat. It was my cousin's Drascombe lugger, and he was very proud of it. And as we sailed around Baltimore Bay, I wondered why it was this boat, above all boats, that had taken my fancy. Was it the lovely peppermint green colour? Was it the dramatic oxblood sails? No, it was something else. It was something about the way that it sat on the waves, the lovely two-masted balance of it. And then I remembered falling in love before with the same two-masted shape. It was on a flashcard pinned up on the cupboard in Mrs. Silk's junior room in Morris National School. The cupboard was painted in that ubiquitous brown paint with the cream grain in it that you saw everywhere in the 50s, just like the counter in Mr. Rice's grocery shop across the road from our house. If I looked out the window from my schoolroom, I could see Mr. Rice outside his shop, where I bought threepenny ice creams, and where sometimes he gave me extra ice cream scrapings that he called butter and jam. And then I looked back up at the card pinned to the cupboard and at the written shape on it. And at that very instant, I realized that I could read it. That with its two tall masked letters and its two short ones, it was L-I-K-E, like. I like ice cream, I thought. And I like Mr. Rice. And that was the start of a great romance with words, and how they sail across the front page of a newspaper, or bob along at the end of a line of poetry, or electrify an otherwise boring political speech. Like was a great word to start with, and because I'd been given this gift of words, I liked school, and I liked teachers who'd shared all of this magic with me. So it'll come as no surprise to you when I say that one of my favorite quotations from scripture is, "In the beginning was the Word." And I use that opening sentence from St. John's Gospel not to present myself in any way as a lay preacher, but to plead for the preservation and the survival of words and the language of words at a time when it seems to me that they're under threat. And where better to make that plea than at a ceremony of the American College, whose Irish campus is named after our great Irish dramatist, Oscar Wilde, and whose new graduates today include so many who are experts in the verbal arts, as well, of course, as those who study business and management. Language affects us all. Poets are the great maestros and divas of words, who glory in the richness of language, and are always exploring where and how far it can go. They also have this uncanny knack for prophecy, a prescience which comes, I think, from their constant search for truth in words. So it's no accident that over 60 years ago, the great Northern Ireland poet, Louis MacNeice, wrote this poem only a few years before he died. To posterity. When books have all seized up like the books in graveyards, and reading and even speaking have been replaced by other less difficult media, we wonder if you will find in flowers and fruit the same color and taste they held for us for whom they were framed in words. And will your grass be green, your sky blue, or will your birds be always wingless birds? So, I look around me at a world where increasingly in conversational speech, I'm noticing an impoverished vocabulary. My daughter put it well. My generation, Mum, speaks in exclamation marks, not in words. And oh my God, that is so true. There is a need to go straight to hyperbole, to presume that the word amazing, or even so amazing, scattered liberally with exclamation marks like hundreds and thousands on an ice cream cone, will do for all and every occasion. When you think of all the words that there are in the Oxford or Chambers or Collins Dictionary, isn't it a pity that we don't take them out and give them a run down the catwalk and let them strut their stuff? And when someone sends me a short message dressed up with an emoji, a smiley face, or a tearful face, I feel sad that they didn't take the opportunity to choose the words that would describe the way they felt, instead of sending me a commodified, standardized image, the equivalent of a bunch of sterile filling station forecourt flowers. So, what am I talking about exactly? I'm one of those old pedants who thinks that all slang words are a crime and that we should all speak as though we've just walked out of a Jane Austen or a John Banville or a Henry James novel. No, though I'm conscious of the laziness of many slang words and how dated they can make people sound, and I still admire the balance and the elegance of a Jane Austen or a John Banville sentence in the same way that I admire a piece of classical sculpture. Neither am I suggesting that local dialect words or phrases impoverish the language. On the contrary, in most cases, they enrich a language as Hiberno-English does, as American English has. No, what I'm talking about is how we are reducing the actual range of the words we use when writing or speaking. A bit like having a whole orchestra, but using only the percussion. Of playing an organ and pulling out only one stop. Of having the full range of John McEnroe tennis shots and using only the forehand. Of having a full palette of colours, but using only black. And the joy of words, you know, the importance of knowing the origin of words. Take a word like sincere, sincerus, knowing that it comes from the Latin sincerus, without wax. Knowing that that's the perfect way to describe somebody who is, as you see them, unvarnished, unshiny. Or take the word for a plant that you all know, and know that there are two words for it. Take the word convolvulus for that lovely plant, weed, you're going to find in the garden with its white trumpets, and the Latinate name describing the wonderful sinuous energy with which it climbs up plants. Or decide instead to call it by its Anglo-Saxon name, bindweed, and to savour the stolid, rock-like nature of those Anglo-Saxon words. Or take Seamus Heaney's Digging, that wonderful poem, just to indicate I'm not talking about fancy words, but I am talking about a consciousness of how you can carefully choose words to get the effect that you want. And Seamus, when he's talking about the fact that he doesn't dig like his father, he has to use a different sort of instrument. And he says, between my finger and my thumb, the squat pen rests. I dig with it. Carefully choosing monosyllabic words, mostly Old English, Anglo-Saxon words, to give that plain, down-to-earth, down-to-the-ground effect that he wants to achieve. So, again, coming back to the disappearance of words from our vocabulary and my concern about it. And there are a number of reasons why it's happening. Firstly, it seems to me an emphasis on immediate communication these days, whether it be by telephone, text, email, or Twitter, which means that speed is paramount. And to express something thoroughly, precisely, and with depth and elegance takes time and thought. It's affecting my own craft of journalism badly. The Twitter message of 140, or isn't it now to be 280 characters, leaves no room for balance or elucidation. The increasing dependence of a whole generation for its news or current affairs on free social media, instead of paying for a quality and monitored news source, means a deterioration not only in the quality of the news commentary they receive, but in the nature of the language that's used. May I make a plea here for my profession? Guys and gals, would you ever pay for monitoring news. It's well worth doing by the quality. And there's also evidence that our vocabularies are shrinking because of our dependence on digital rather than oral communication. According to a study done by Marco Cattani, senior lecturer at King's College in London, internet devices are visual rather than auditory, so it's likely that children will end up with a lower average number of words than previous generations. In other words, our vocabularies are shrinking because we're simply not talking to one another as much. Look around you in the train, as I did on the way in here this morning, or on the bus. People aren't talking to one another the way they used to. They're on their screens. What I find really sad is to see young parents walking their toddlers, and instead of talking to those extraordinary little faces turned up at them, beautiful recipient little beings, parents are turned away instead on their phones. But how do children learn speech and words? By hearing and by repetition. A recent study by a group from the institution's Markets Technologies Lucca Institute for Advanced Studies in Italy in the Journal of Scientific Reports indicates that more words are becoming extinct than ever before, and fewer words are being introduced to make up for the loss. The result is that languages appear to be shrinking, and at an increasing rate, and that this has all happened in the digital age in the last 20 years. The second reason, it seems to me, why the language of our daily communication is becoming poorer is an increasing emphasis on specialization in almost every area of knowledge, which has produced a whole series of specialized terminologies which are meant quite deliberately to exclude the generally well-educated outsider. As a result, many highly educated academics hide in terminology. Instead of fine words in the English language, terms which will explain very well what they mean and which will satisfyingly enrich the language that we speak every day. Of course I accept that there are specific scientific terms that need to be used in areas of science and medicine to describe properly and precisely what is going on. But do historians, sociologists, professors of literature, for God's sake, need to retreat behind pseudoscientific terminology, flat, robotic language meant to put any discussion of the subject beyond the reach of the average well-read and educated person, just to make it seem somehow more intelligent? How many of those who teach literature can write with the clarity and the power of a George Steiner or a Dennis Dunne? I remember studying literature at university all those years ago and hating the diet of stodgy suet pudding literary criticism that we had to read, mostly F.R. and Queenie Leavis, who were fashionable at the time. And it put me off literary criticism for life until I came to read Seamus Heaney's wonderful collected Oxford lectures, The Redress of Poetry. How many academics can write about literature with the simplicity and energy of a Seamus Heaney, or a Ted Hughes, or a Vonnegut, or an Elizabeth Bishop, or a Mary Oliver, or an Evan Boland? The people who live by the word, as Heaney and Hughes and Boland and Brooke did and do, don't need to hide behind terminology. And going back to the scientists and the doctors, yes, they have to use a precise scientific language, but not all the time, and not to exclude the people who are the consumers of their products and services. Why is it that communication with patients is now emerging as one of the major failures of the medical schools? Late in the day, they're now trying to teach doctors how to share and explain medical procedures and aftercare to the patient, because an informed patient will respond better than an uninformed one. Why do people have to write Computers for Dummies books because computer scientists and engineers won't come out from behind their terminological walls to communicate with the rest of us? Why are we trusting our money, our security, whole systems of government and justice to computer systems that only a tiny handful of people understand and can manipulate, because we have allowed them to retreat behind the walls of terminology? It's important that we can all speak to one another
in a rich language which is exercised fully and renewed every day. So my plea to you all is this, and I'm conscious of looking down at a generation which is moving to take over the world when I've moved, perhaps, onto stage left or into the wings. So I'm doing this very consciously, because this world is yours, and you can make it or you can bring it. First, talk to one another and to your children when they come. Put the phones away. If you have a chance of talking to real people, use those talking muscles. Take out all the words that you have in your cupboard, all the stops, and flaunt them. Don't retreat behind terminology. Consciously enrich your daily conversation. Try limiting the exclamation marks to one every 300 words. Double the emojis. You don't need them when you have a treasury of words with which to tailor-make your message. Don't just send people holiday pictures or images from your vacation. They're usually really boring. A letter with your impressions and experience is much more interesting, full of colour and wit, and perhaps even pathos. Give the people you love the dignity and the courtesy of a handwritten letter. Last year, my sister-in-law, who lives in New York State, wrote me a long letter on the anniversary of her brother, my husband's death. It was a thoughtful letter and a profound letter, and I read it and I reread it, seeing her kitchen table in White Plains, where she'd written it, knowing that this paper that I had in my hand had literally come from her hand, knowing that these words had been carefully chosen just for me in my particular grief. Remember how powerful words are. Why does the Cyrano de Bergerac story reappear all through literature? The man who was so ugly, but whose way with words could win over the most reluctant names. And let me finish with this point. I had a friend for decades who was a missionary priest in South America. He was the provincial head of his order, and he fought for the poor in the slums of Sao Paulo where he lived. He was a brilliant man. He spoke fluent French, Portuguese, and Spanish. Now he was back in Ireland, dying from an inoperable cancer tumor. When I went to see him, the tumor was affecting his brain, and he could no longer remember the names of things. Put that thing on that thing, he'd say to me, asking me to put my gift on the bedside locker. It was sad. But he said the illness had taught him something. We missionaries, he said, have chosen to live with the poor, to live as they do so that we can understand and help them more. But if you're educated and articulate, you never really know what poverty is. Now that I can't remember words, I realize that for the very first time in my life, I know what it is to be poor. Words are our treasure, our special inheritance that we have to hand on to another generation. So let's handle them as the poets do, like a jeweler searches out the full range of precious stones to find the right gem for that particular setting. Let not your or my generation be the last to know the full beauty and power, the full glory